प्लीज सिट डाउन.
प्लीज टेक योर
सीट. इन द फर्स्ट सेशन वी टॉक्ड अबाउट द इंटरमीडियरीज हु आर देयर इन द फाइनेंशियल मार्केट्स एंड नाउ इन द नेक्स्ट सेशन वी आर गोइंग टू टॉक अबाउट अदर फाइनेंशियल इंस्टीट्यूशंस विच आर पार्ट ऑफ द फाइनेंस इंडस्ट्री. वी हैव विथ अस मिस्टर संदीप घोष who is the head of NISM. And you have heard many times in the course of today's program that you need to be certified. So what certifications are necessary? The entire certifications are done by NISM and Mr. Ghosh heads NISM. And other day I was talking to SEBI chairman and he told me very clearly that NISM is the institution which has been appointed to train skilled professionals for the entire financial market and especially the capital markets. So we have with us a very very relevant person for this program, and that is Mr. Ghosh, who is going to talk about the various careers and the certifications, as well as I have also asked him to talk about what does it take to take up a job with the regulator. So it is important that if you want to work with the regulator, what are the skill sets which are necessary. We have with us Ms. Revati Kasture, who is the Chief General Manager with CARE Ratings. You know, rating agencies are again a very, very important institution so far as the financial market goes. Revati has been is the Chief General Manager and Head of CARE Research, the Research and Information Division of CARE Ratings, and the second largest credit rating in India. She has a total experience of 14 years, in which almost 10 years she has spent with the rating agency. Then we have with us Ms. Rekha Shah. We have a friendship through many decades. Rekha has done her MBA with Jamnalal Bajaj Institute of Management Studies. And she has been, one of the pioneers in surveillance and risk management. You know, she set up, she's the founder of Analyze and Control, which is a company which is very actively involved in providing surveillance and risk management solutions to various brokers and other outfits in the capital market. And last but not the least, we have with us Ms. Rupa Nitsure, who is a PhD and chief economist with the Bank of Baroda. So she is from the banking industry, and she is going to talk to us about the capital market portion. You know, we are not going to talk about banking as, you know, getting deposits and giving loans, but we are going to talk about what is the role of finance and capital markets in the banking industry. So this is our, you know, esteemed panel that we have. And we would like to start, Professor Sir Ghosh. We'll call you Professor Ghosh because now that is the role that you have taken on. Please take us through how it is important to have the requisite skills which are necessary first, because you are the skill imparting agency for the entire finance industry. So please talk to us about how important it is to get the requisite skills to be successful in this industry.
Well, friends, I would request you to settle down. Something which was discussed in the previous panel, that jobs are very easy to get, but how to retain them and rise in those jobs is the difficult part. So what I would try to tell you is what are the critical skills one requires for the 21st century. These skills were already very important, but now they have become much more critical. Everybody who is aspiring for a job desires to join the best job wherever it is possible. However, one thing he misses out is what are the skill sets he or she possesses. And hence, there is always a gap between desire and deserve. So you have to bridge that gap between desire and deserve by working on skills. Now, there is one skill which is known as life skill. The previous panel told you about the life skill. You have to be flexible. That is to say that you can adapt and work in any environment which is there. Second is, you have to have the right attitude. You should be able to be amicable and friendly. You should have social skills. So you have to do some introspection to find out, do you have these life skills? Then there are some literary skills. For example, can you read and read comfortably? Navneet was saying that the best way to grow is to read more, meet more. I would say that people who read are people who lead. Do you read? A very average reader reads close to 45 to 50 books in a year. These books can be anything, fiction, non-fiction, academically oriented, self-help books, whatever you read. But a very, very average reader reads 45 to 50 books in a year. So please look at your reading skills. Do you read? This is one of the skills, because if you don't read, you will not be able to write. Writing comes out of reading. The first skill which you will lose is writing if you don't read. Sometimes when I work with the technology group of people, I tell them that you work so much on technology, please don't lose the habit of reading. At least when you are traveling to your workplace and back, pick up a book and read. Because if you are constantly engaged in technology, one skill which may go is the reading skill and the writing skill. Then there is a skill today which we call as media literacy. Media literacy need not mean the media which way we understand, but media literacy is e-book, internet, Facebook. Facebook doesn't mean to put your house. That is what today's Facebook is, that we put our drawing room for public display. I am being slightly sensitive by saying drawing room. People are actually putting their bedroom for public display. That is not Facebook. And we have to understand that. Then do you have critical skills like creative thinking? Do you have the basic skills of communication? Please look at these things seriously, and while you are engaged in your academic curriculum, please work on communication skills. Reading, writing, speaking, listening are basic skills which is required for any workplace. I have been in this job for the last 40 years, and believe me, whichever department I have worked, and which are quite a few, when we were wanting to have people, we will say, give me a person who can read, write, speak and listen. I don't want anything else. All the qualifications which you garner over the period of years are gate passes to organizations. But your survival in organization will depend, do you have these skills? I would also like to say one more thing before Dina Ban goes to the other panelists, is just get out, for it is a competitive world, but we are not living in Darwinian time. It is not the survival of the fittest anymore. We are living in a collaborative world. If you cannot collaborate, if you are always competitive, life is not going to be good. And you are going to be working for 50 years, as the previous panelists were saying, whether you like it or not. Either join a government job where you get a pension, and that also now the new pension scheme, you subscribe for it. It is no more the old pension scheme where you get pension as per whatever your salaries were. Now you subscribe for a pension scheme. If you don't subscribe for your pension scheme just to maintain your livelihood, you will have to work till the time you are alive. So if that is the race which you have to get into, and which is 50 years of strong working, careers is not a 100 meters dash. It is a steeple chase. Sometimes you will be on 45 degree inclination, and sometimes you will be going down the hill with a speed which is will be difficult to control. And you have to take this in stride, that if you have a good winter, you are also going to have a good summer and a good monsoon. It's not going to be pleasant throughout the year. It is going to be difficult. And these facts, you have to decide. I would just say that if you enjoyed Three Idiots, then look at the last dialogue which was playing on when this intelligent man was running after Amir Khan. And the dialogue behind was saying that apne ko itna buland banao ki kamyabi khud piche bhagegi. And that is what you need to do today. Ki apne ko buland banao. Har aadmi dekh raha hai, dusra aadmi kya kar raha hai. Aur khud kya kar raha hai, usse koi matlab nahi hai. Do we sit with ourselves? Do we reflect? Do we review? Do we look at goals? And don't shift the goals. Shift your strategy. Most of the time, the easiest thing is to do, if I wanted to do 20 things, and mid-year I find I've done nothing, I then take a decision, okay, not 20, let us do 10 things. And then, closer to the end of the year, if I am not 10, chalo 5 to karna hai. Don't move the goals, move the strategies, move your efforts. If you get into the habit of moving goals, life would become difficult. I'll come back again. But life skills are very important. Look at yourself. If not anything else, when you are going back in the train today, just sit with that paper and pen and write down 5 good strengths which you have. I'm sure if I pick up any one of you and just ask you to tell me 5 strengths you have, you will find it difficult to answer that question.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Ghosh is having a very, very enlightened career. He has been assisting so many Reserve Bank governors before he took on this assignment of this. Of course, in the course of the discussion, we will be asking him what are the type of skill set development that NISM is doing, because today it is now the nodal agency for development for the entire financial market. I would like to go on to Revati. Revati, if you could just describe your career, and through that we would try to understand what is it takes to be successful in a rating agency. What are the kind of skill sets and what are the challenges and career path that you see for yourself, and which even these young people can look at.
So, at the cost of being pompous, I would actually start by saying that there is nothing that you have to say no to in when you kind of join an organization, because every opportunity, every challenge which is thrown up to you is an opportunity to learn. So when I joined an organization, I actually started my career with CARE Ratings and then traveled a few organizations before I've landed again with CARE Ratings. But the first job which was given to me is that we were developing an in-house model. And they told me, you try and debug this model. It was a software program which TCS was writing for us. So you debug this program. I said, I'm a merit holder chartered accountant, if I would have said that. How can they tell me to debug a TCS model which is getting developed? I didn't say that, thankfully. And that's the reason I learned for the first time what goes into building of a rating model. I would have otherwise never done that. And it helped me now, 10 years ago, when we at CARE set up our own internal rating model and developed it completely indigenous within the company, and that project was done by me. The only reason that I could do it is that some long years back, I had some amount of information on how exactly would you work with when you are developing a model. So, you generally should not say no to any kind of work which is given to you. I find that as an attitudinal issue with many of the youngsters who join and are put on projects which are not rating related. Okay, you know, I'm not doing a case for 6 months. I mean, you're putting me on a project which I would lose out on knowing so many companies. I don't think you have a career of 6 months. You probably have a career of 20 years or 40 years, you know, as Professor Ghosh is saying. So don't measure your career by the 6 months time that you spend in doing a non-core activity. It will definitely help you and better your core skills in doing your job. So that's probably, you know, one attitudinal thing which I want to communicate to all of you over here. The second thing is that being a lady, I would say always prioritize your job. There's nothing like, you know, oh, if I don't take this promotion right now, I'm going to lose out on so many different things. It's not that. There's always a time and place for everything, and it will definitely come back to you. So don't ever think that, you know, now or never. There's always an opportunity which goes in the future, and everything happens for the best. So think about that, and when you join an organization, think that you want to learn and you want to be with the organization for a long time to come. Think of a career in that organization rather than, you know, what's in it for me. Rather than always saying what's in it for me, always try to reflect in it, what do I give to the organization so that the organization gives me. That I think is very important.
Thank you, Revati. I think, of course, besides the life learning of never saying no, I think one very important point that comes out is understanding technology. And as we have said, see, all jobs are essentially increasingly going to be technology driven, and the application of mind is going to, you know, be on analyzing various data, on analyzing various things, and using technology. Like if you look at trading, you know, today, trading, what we used to trade in this ring by doing sign language, today trading is completely automated. There is no physical intervention which is there. The customer calls, you just look at the screen, what is the rate, and you just punch the order. That's all, you know, which dealing has today resorted to. So when, you know, if you look at risk management, I mean, in risk also, there are so many softwares which are available. You need to understand those software. What is the alert which the software is generating, and how to interpret that alert? Like, for example, it gives an alert, say that my customer has traded in 5% of the market. Means the total volume which was there of the market, my customer has traded 5%, which is substantial. So then interpreting those signals, I think that is what things are leading to. So for which you need a very strong, you know, understanding of software's application, how it works, what is the kind of output. So I would now ask Rekha, you know, to just take us through of, you know, how technology has you know, evolved so far as risk management and surveillance systems are concerned, and what is the role which these students would play in, you know, such a technology heavy kind of environment.
Thank you, Dinamin. I'm sorry. One of the, I think, landmark things about capital markets have been the way technology has been used in the capital markets over a period of last two decades. I mean, as she said, from a sign language and from the time where client used to come and, you know, the broker used to maybe sit and maybe evaluate if the client is good enough, or the broker just knows the client, so he enrolls him as a client and starts the business from that time to today, where there is a complex client account opening form to a centralized risk management, where 20 years back a default was something may not be uncommon. But the way regulators have introduced technology, the way the exchanges have adopted technology today, having a default for a broker is something unheard of. And this was only possible with the way the technology was adopted and with the way risk was integrated into the technology. It was not just about trading. It was just not about automation of trading. But it was all about the credit and default risk, the way it was embedded into the entire trading system. So that was a landmark thing which happened and which has ensured that today we have a robust capital market which is internationally being looked on. And that is how you see that a lot of institutional investors all across the world, and it was not just national level, but international level investors have flocked into our market. And India has seen a great rise in the growth of capital market to the extent where at one time, capital market was a household business. Okay, today it is being looked at by professionals very keenly because it has all the ingredients of, you know, not only a good job but a glamorous job also. So that is what I would say, that risk management and technology and trading automation played a very significant role in this market.
Actually, I would like to give you some perspective how markets have grown. See, in the pre-Harshad Mehta days, average daily turnover of Bombay Stock Exchange was 200 crores. In Harshad Mehta days, when, you know, lot of activity happened, we had a turnover of 600 crores. And today we have average daily turnover of 3 lakh plus crores. Okay? So you can imagine how much it has grown in just a matter of 20 years. In 1995, I think on 17th of January, BSE went online, and in 1994, November, NSE went online. So, you know, from 1994 to 2014, about 22 years, today we are in 2015, we have, you know, moved so much. And this is all because of technology. You know, so one very important thing is technology has made, you know, reach all across the country because of the VSAT network, because of internet. Anybody in India sitting anywhere can trade. And the beauty of this is that you are in Jhumri Talaya. The banking service may be very poor. Your mobile, you keep on doing hello, hello. The, you know, the signals are not good. But when it comes to stock exchange trading, the trader sitting in Mumbai and trader sitting in Jhumri Talaya get same 200 or millisecond or whatever second response. So, you know, that is the beauty which technology. And other thing which she has said, integrating technology and risk with trading. Earlier, you know, when a customer would give order, we would not sit and check in the ledger, does he have money? But today, because of technology, every time an order comes into the system, it is checked. Is there money in the client's account? If yes, then only the order goes forward. And because of this, you know, we have introduced the Trade Guarantee Fund, which is in 1996. From 1996 till 2015, there has not been a single default in the stock markets. Okay? There has the pain, you know, which happens at 9:30 and payout which happens at 11:15 has never ever been delayed. See, there have been floods in Mumbai city, there have been bomb blasts in Mumbai city, there have been power failures in Mumbai city, but never ever has pain been delayed. So this is integration of technology. So technology is a very important tool when it comes to the, you know, financial market, and understanding technology, how it works, I think that is a very, very important milestone. And what Rekha has rightly said, that even in risk and surveillance, which is a very, very important career, you know, you look at careers, there is front office, there is middle office, and there is back office. So front office is what Aditya was talking about in the earlier session, which is, you know, frontline jobs, interacting with customers. And the middle office is where she comes from, which is risk risk and surveillance. And then there is back office. Now, I think I'll go to Rupa. You know, Rupa is in the banking sector. And normally when we talk of banking sector, you know, all freshers, they get jobs only one, which is mobilization of deposits. You know, some private bank will give you a higher salary. You will get an SMS at 1:30 at night saying that your target is short by so many lakh rupees. This is the kind of, you know, performance which is expected is from you. But besides this, you know, and of course, loans and advances, books which these have. Besides that, there are a lot of career, capital market related career opportunities which are there. So I would ask, request Rupa to talk about these career opportunities within the banking sector.
Hello. Yeah, thank you. Having spoken so much about technology and risk management, I would again get back to what Professor Ghosh was saying about the whole requirement of having a research think tank within an organization, whether it's a bank or a corporation or stock market. And you see, for a banking entity, because to do their business, they need funds. One source of funds is, of course, deposits. But they also do a lot of borrowings from capital markets. So capital raising is very important part of it. And secondly, these are all listed companies. So a lot of, institutional as well as retail people, retail investors, have stakes in that. So as a part of market discipline, these entities are expected to have an ongoing dialogue with investors. Now, though my specialization is in economics and I am supposed to be, giving anti-forecasts on key macro parameters like interest rates or liquidity or inflation or policy signals, other thing is that I also oversee investor relations. Because all banks, as I said, most of the important banks, they are the listed entities. And when you have raised money from the capital markets, as a part of market discipline, it is your duty to have an ongoing dialogue with the investors. They will have a lot of queries. Most of the institutional investors, they have their quant models. So they require, your definite views and projections on important parameters, your views on banking sector outlook, overall macroeconomic outlook. An important thing which I would like to highlight here is that in the long run, what really helps is intellectual honesty and your commitment to research and studying. Because, I always say that my job in a bank is like my OPD, outpatient department, where I get lot of, exciting problem-solving assignments. But then, that also keeps telling me about the pathology of the economy, of the banking industry, because I'm continuously scanning macroeconomic environment, regulatory environments. I'm doing impact analysis. Banks also have very large treasury operations. So from there also we have a lot of exposure to capital markets. So daily we have to take stock of the liquidity positions, how we are going to deploy it, because not always, you have a good business cycle where you can do a lot of lending and earn good returns. You also have to manage treasury efficiently so that, you combine your interest income with fee-based income, non-interest income, trading gains, exchange-traded profits. So, but I would say one thing, that capital market interaction has brought in a lot of discipline in the banking industry. I say more than any university, my real university where I've learned is my interaction with investors. Because their surveillance, their scrutiny is online and ongoing. It's not like regulatory scrutiny which may happen once in a quarter or once in a year. So even when a particular firm or a bank is posting its results, and if there is anything, where investors feel that this is not correct or this is an error, immediately you'll start getting calls. Immediately you'll start getting emails. Regulators may realize that after a while when they come for inspection. So I think market discipline is very important, and any interaction with capital market participants, it keeps you on your toes. But then to cope up with that, you have to invest a lot of energy in reading, researching, and also learning a lot of mathematical statistics, because mathematical statistics, econometrics are very important tools which any economist needs to take care of the forecasting assignments. Thank you.
So I think, what Rupa is trying to say is that the banking business, which is, lending and borrowing, is something that we all understand what banking is all about. There is a lot more that goes into the entire banking industry, and more so since banks have now started getting listed, and that is really throwing up, keeping them on the toes and throwing up a lot of challenges so far as you know the people who are employed in this industry. So of course it may not be that you will directly, once you know banking system how it is structured, you know there are recruitment happens, they take on probationary officers and that is the route people go, and then they may be assigned any job. You know, something about banking very unique is you keep getting different you know assignments, you get transferred very frequently, and by the time you land up as an economist job it will be a long way off. So I think a faster way, you know, if we look at the banking conclave, they have been asking lot of freedom in recruiting people. So I'm sure that if you train yourself, you know, like research analyst, or you get yourself experienced and trained in a particular area, then it would be, I would say, relatively maybe direct entry would be possible. But of course, otherwise, you really need to upgrade your skills sufficiently for the bank management to identify you and to, you know, put you in that section. So that is the, you know, kind of career opportunities that are there in banking other than the traditional banking. Sir, I would come to you. I would, you know, want you to throw light on what are the kind of programs which are offered by NISM and what are the skill sets, you know, that you certify and train the people, because you have got a whole variety of, you know, programs which start with middle office, back office, front office, everything you are covering. So could you throw some light on those?
See, what has happened, especially in the capital markets, unlike the other areas of finance, which is insurance, banking, pension, and the FMCs. In capital market, in the last 20 years, there has been a radical change. And much of this change has been pushed through technology. Now, with this change comes responsibility. If you were doing daily trading of 200 crores and today you are doing in lakhs of crores, then there is a huge responsibility which gets into the market space. And one of the ways in which regulators can look at the market space is to professionalize the markets as much as possible. And I would say that it has been a big task, but these three institutes, which is NISM, the BSC Institute and the NSC Institutes, created certificates in different areas of the capital market space. And today we have 17 mandated certificates without which you cannot operate in the securities markets. And there are many aspirational certificates which helps you in learning more about these mandated certificates. And these mandated certificates, if you look at them, they can be clubbed into five major sectors. One set of certificates makes you competent to work in the risk and compliance area. Another set of certificates helps you to work in sales and distribution. Another set of certificates help you to work in the whole mutual fund industry. Another set of certificates help you to work in the currency derivatives, equity derivatives. And like this, there are these groups of certificates. So when you look at these certificates, please look at which area you would like to work in. Although I am not a believer of this particular thought, I personally feel in a career of four decades, in the first 10 years, you are a Parshuram. You have to work in whichever area you are assigned work. And your only job is to rise to the level of excellence in that area which is assigned to you. If you can do that, believe me, graduating into the next 10 years, which is the phase of Ram or the leadership phase, becomes much easier. Because you are competent, you know each and every area of work, you have not shied away from anything, you have dirtied your nails, you have soiled your shoes, and you have worked over time to be the best. Your only performance appraisal is that if work was created in the department, they were looking for you. If you have created that type of profile, you don't have to bother about the annual and quarterly performance review. So if you are a very successful Ram, in the next 10 years, you can graduate into Krishna, who is the leaders of leader, who is a guide, who is a mentor, who is a philosopher, who is a counselor, who is a coach, and who deals with leaders in different places. Leaders have a limitation. Leaders who have followers can add to growth. Leaders who lead leaders can multiply growth. And if you have been a successful Krishna, then you can work the last 10 years as a Buddha who knows everything, who's a statesman, who's a visionary, who can look at tomorrow. And these phases you have to go through. You cannot be a Buddha in the first 10 years, whatever may be the speed of technology. What has not changed in India, that along with the fast changing in technology we have leapfrogged into current times, but in attitudes we still remain to be purely agrarian. If you look at the technology giants, who were the creator of the best technology which we use today, many of them were school dropouts. Many of them worked from small remote places and created something which is internet. We use it without any thought. But imagine the power of internet. You use it without any cost and anything. You just put a search and it is there. But internet has a problem. Technology has a problem. And it is segmented. You have data. If you are intelligent enough, you will convert data into information. If you are really wise, you will convert information into knowledge. And if you are wiser, knowledge would become wisdom. The important part is, bulk of us are in that data phase. We are unable to move from data to information, and information to knowledge, and knowledge to wisdom. It is that challenge which you have to overcome in technology. These certificates are important while you are working, while you are doing your MBA, while you are doing your BCom, while you are doing your MCom. This is the best time. They are very easy certificates. You have a workbook. They are all online examinations. You can start taking them at an early age and do it in these groups. So that if you have one group, you know at least somebody who looks at your profile looks at it from that group. Banking did not distinguish what Deenaben was saying. You joined as a probationary officer, and depending on your strengths, you moved from department to department, and you could. We have so many examples. I worked for the Reserve Bank for more than 3 decades. We had example of a deputy governor who had started his career as a part-time typist. He grew up to be chairman of 3 major banks and then deputy governor of the Reserve Bank. So it is not what all you have. It is what all you have is what is going to be important. He was not deterred that he started his career, because it is not important where you start. Most of the people today are very busy in finding out what is the starting salary. You have to find out where you will land up when you are at the age of 50. And you will be surprised that even from the best premier management schools, very few of them cross 40 and retain their jobs. Because they were very, very, very eager and very, very inquisitive as to where I will start. It's not where you start. It is where you finish and how long you are going to be in the finishing line. Can you be in the leadership position for 10 to 15 years? Then you are somebody. In 1981, Rangarajan joined as deputy governor. And today, in 2013, he moved away from the Prime Minister's secretariat. So imagine 81 to 2013, He has been in the top when he's just started as a lecturer in a small college. So it's not where you start, it's how long and how much you can be at the top. I started my career as a research scholar in history. And then today when Dinaban calls me professor, maybe I look like one. It was a big challenge. 10 years as head of governor's office working with Rangarajan, Jalan and Reddy. And everybody who would come would address you as Dr. Ghosh, because they would feel if you are sitting in this office, at least you would be a PhD. At least, but, and then you have to justify that you are Dr. Ghosh. You had to have more information, more knowledge, more wisdom than bulk of the people who would come to meet these top people. And then you have to drive yourself into learning, continuous learning on an ongoing basis. So these certificates are very easily, whether it is NISM certificate, whether it is BSc Institute certificate, whether it is NSC Institute certificate, you can do it at any point of time. All these, there are two type of traits or skills which we have. One of them is inherited, like the color of the skin, like sometimes you walk. If somebody observes you from the back, they can say you walk like your mother or you walk like your father. In the males, it is the balding pattern. You inherit it. You may use any hair oil, but you will bald because there is a balding pattern gene. On the day you are born, they can tell you how you will bald. But the whole beauty industry survives today on this inherited traits. There is fair and lovely, we keep on using it. But your skin color is dependent not on fair and lovely. It is dependent on the melanin which the skin has. And either you have to be Michael Jackson and get that melanin removed, or you have to continue to be like that. But there is a whole area of acquired skills which is in our hand, which we can acquire without any problem. But we don't concentrate on the acquired skills. We keep on fighting that whether hair is looking good, whether skin is looking good. It doesn't work. I would request you to look at the certificates, professionalize yourself, because anybody in the market who deals with you wants to know who you are. They don't want to deal with any and everybody.
See, actually, unlike other industries, it is mandatory. Suppose you want to join the front office of a broker, you cannot operate a terminal unless and until you have a NISM certificate, which allows you to actually operate the terminal. And there is a difference between cash and derivatives. You want to operate a derivatives terminal, you require a derivative certification. If you want to operate a currency terminal, you require that certification. You want to work in the back office, then you require the back office operations certification. So, Rekha, I would come to you that, you know, see, these colleges, they are not at all thought anything about security laws or, you know, anything to do with compliance. Essentially, what they are thought is, you know, accounting, organization of commerce and economics. But laws, when it comes to laws, maximum law that students are taught is Income Tax Act, you know, income tax and to some extent some indirect taxes. So do you think that this whole deficiency which is there in the education system of not teaching laws relating to security market is somewhat fulfilled by doing these certification courses? Would you really understand about law if you were to do these certification courses?
Yeah, I think these certification courses are really a good, they're a good supplement. They really help to understand at least basic aspects of what is expected when they come to do that skill. So it is not that the person, like for example, someone joining without an NISM certification to a back office would have no idea that how a trade is settled or when does a trade happen, when is a delivery given. They will have no idea. But if they have done that certification, then at least that basic level of understanding is available. But of course, what you learn on the job is something which only that experience will provide you. But what the employers look at is at least basically you understand something, you're able to pick that up, you're able to deliver it. I mean, that is what they expect. And from there on, you build onto the actual job profile. But I think what would really help is the courses which are there on the management institutes. They should have some internships onto, you know, these kind of roles. That would really help them, not only in terms of getting an exposure, but also in terms of deciding what career option they want. Because today, if a person wants a career option of a risk management or of a compliance, I think what they understand is only, okay, if it's compliance, it is laws. Okay, what they understand is if it is risk management, then okay, you know, it is somewhere, some risk is there. And they have to manage that risk. But what is at risk? What they have to manage? What is compliance risk? They are quite at loss till they actually get into the groove of their job. But yes, the certifications definitely give you a basic level of understanding.
I think, you know, certifications are important for anything that you do. Because if you are a fund manager with a mutual fund, then, you know, you need to know about what are the insider trading laws, what is the front running, what is a fraudulent and unfair trade practice. And every professional is required to sign a code, you know, which is like now we have the research analyst code. So every analyst, every person employed has to sign some code or the other. So, you know, knowledge of law, like I told you, technology was very, very important. That way, you know, knowledge of securities law is also very important because for everything that you do, there is some law or the other. So, you know, Revati, I would like to know from you that, you know, for credit rating agency, if somebody were to, like we said, if you are in a broking, mutual fund and other outfits, you need to understand what is the, you know, compliance angle which is there. So, how do you prepare for a, you know, rating agency job, and what is the kind of, you know, legal background that irrespective of anything, any work that you do in this industry, you need to know this?
See, at present, there are no mandatory certifications that are to be done to join as an analyst at the rating agency. Just like there are mandatory certifications for a research analyst in a broking firm, at present there are none for joining as a rating analyst in a rating agency. But definitely what is required to be done, rating agencies typically look at postgraduate students. So we look at MBAs or CAs or CFAs. So just doing a basic graduation degree will not be enough for being employed. There can be a debate on, you know, whether a postgraduate graduation degree actually prepares you for such a job or not. I mean, but at least as a screening point, we look at a postgraduation degree, whether it is an MBA or a CA or a CWE or a CFA, whatever, or a professional degree when you want to apply. And what I find, what we look at when we recruit students actually is their general awareness. What you're taught in colleges is that, you know, you kind of are taught financial management, financial analysis, ratio analysis, and all those things are taught. But how do you actually apply those ratios? So when we actually do an interview, we try and understand whether the student has followed what is taught in college and the fundamental understanding of the subject is right, or that itself is a bit flawed. Plus, we also try and understand whether he's clued with the happenings in the markets, with the financial markets. I think Aditya in the earlier session raised a very, very important question, is how many of you really read financial newspapers? Because to do a rating, firstly, what is rating is a question itself that many students cannot answer. Because rating is a very niche area. It's not an area which is very widely done across, you know, the capital markets. It's a very niche, specialized
expert area, which is you know, assessment of credit risk, which is done either at rating agencies or at banks or at mutual funds, the debt side of the mutual funds, or even as you know, Rekha said earlier, when we're doing a trade, assessing the credit risk part of whether you know when a broker does a trade, whether his client will be able to pay or not. That's also part of credit risk, which is largely taken care by the regulatory environment in the country. But when we're doing credit risk assessment, it is based on expert judgment. And when you're talking about expert judgment-based analysis, you definitely need to be more aware of what's happening to companies, what's happening to different regulations, whether it is the Companies Act or the Income Tax Act or the foreign exchange guidelines which are coming up. And you also need to be aware of all the economic parameters, because when we do analysis, it's always economy, industry, company. So you definitely need to be aware of the economic happenings, then what's happening in different industries, and then what's happening in the company that I'm actually trying to assess. These kind of skills are required for a person to work at as a rating analyst.
But I think now the new research analyst regulations are going to it is not as of now applicable, but the way SEBI is spreading the net, it will not be the day will not be very far where anybody wanting to be a research analyst must register, means the company has to register, and all the analysts also need to be registered, and they need to follow certain rules and regulations. I think before I throw the house open, I think Rupa, you could talk to us about how does these new entrants who are there, how do they actually say that I want to be part of the capital market business? Of is there any opportunity for them to directly go into those kind of services, and what is the what do they need to do to be there, landing up a job over there?
Sure. Actually, what we discussed earlier was very traditional kind of banking roles, but we all know that banking has evolved considerably and has become a very complex function. So, broadly there are two categories. One is of a generalist and one specialist. So, if you have to, if you come with any specialized qualifications, say in economics or in risk management, if you have done a lot of, mathematical statistics or you have done graduation or post graduation from say Indian Statistical Institute, then that opens up opportunities in the field of risk management. If you have if you have taken any additional training or done some research or done your own work in say forex related aspects, then you have very good opportunities in treasury. So point is that, but still I would say that a lot is being said about the ABRARI qualifications. But in my opinion and in my observation, the real training that you get for any particular job is, by working on real problem-solving assignments and gaining work experience. So maybe, at the time of your interview, you can, they ask you for a choice. And if you want to join a specialist cadre, then there is a different level of type of scrutiny, exams and all. But I won't say that is a sufficient condition. That is just a necessary condition. What really equips you for a particular role is the actual exposure and the actual work experience. Okay. Yeah, thank you.
Okay, I think now we have tried to give you, in a snapshot, what are the certifications which are necessary, and we have got a variety of roles over here, being in part of the capital market in banking sector or being part of the risk surveillance in any industry. In fact, this applies to broking, mutual funds, and every industry, so far as every section I would say of the financial market needs to have a very, very strong middle office. Which Rekha talked about, and we had Revati who talked about the credit rating and how what are the opportunities. So I think in a snapshot, I think what is very important, which I would say summarize for this thing, is as Professor rightly said, that it is important to read, to meet, to assimilate, to understand. And I think reading is something which each and every speaker has spoken about. You need to constantly read. That is going to be very, very important. And, you know, getting a job is very easy. As you know, so much recruitment is happening all over the place. But what is important is how do you stay on to the job and how do you grow? You know, growing from being a Parshuram to Ram and Krishna and Buddha. I think that is what is in your hands, you know, where a lot of skill development and continuously feeding yourself. You know, today at least I read 6 newspapers end to end. So, you know, this is the kind of, and my children, they do read, but, you know, like my younger son, he will read, suppose if there is some incident in Palestine, he will read the Israeli newspaper as well as the Palestinian newspaper. So that kind of curiosity, if we have, I think that would really, because this is one place where you may not realize, but information pays. You know, more information you have than the next guy, you can interpret the market better. Maybe you can take advantage of the market better. You can advise your clients better. You can advise your bosses better. So information and knowledge, you know, information converted to knowledge is something. And how do you get knowledge? You need to read and you need to constantly go on absorbing things. So I think, so this is a very knowledge, you know, driven kind of industry. Which I think is the underlying requirement. And another thing is that constant upgradation of knowledge. You know, just having knowledge, you know how to run a particular machine and you go on running that machine all your life is not something which is possible. Over here, every role requires constant upgradation of knowledge. So I think this is a very, very too much thing, too much challenge, or it can be somebody who really likes challenges. Oh, this is where we need to be. Rekha, you want to add something?
Yes, exactly. On the point which she said, you know, how information can be converted, data or information can be converted to knowledge is what I want to add there. Even on the risk side, like as we said, you know, when we started with risk as a credit risk. In the sense, the exchanges integrated the entire risk aspect of credit risk, whether the broker or the client can pay or not pay. But if you observe in the last few years, the surveillance risk and the anti-money laundering risk, that has become a priority aspect for the regulators, because surveillance risk now is whether the client, who is, as she said, can trade from Jumri Talaiya, whether the client is manipulating the market in any way so that by manipulation that client may benefit, but there is a huge lot of investors who would end up getting into huge losses. So whether that is happening. So now there is a evolution, there is a maturity on the risk management that has happened. And just to touch on the point of how information is converted into knowledge is that even to get into, you know, what kind of software we can make on surveillance and anti-money laundering, we actually studied more than 500 SEBI orders, which are on the website, of SEBI, website. We studied 500 SEBI orders. That was the information we had. We actually created patterns out of those orders, and that is what we converted into technology. Is just what I want you all to understand, that that is how maybe the regulator had done, that is how it inspired us to create that kind of risk management for the industry which we have been catering to throughout our career.
I think before I, just one small information I want to give you. Before the seminar, I was asking a lot of students, what is your expectation from this program? Of course, some people had an expectation that we'll come here and learn how to invest because you are in the stock exchange building. For which I would like to tell you is that IMC has what is called as an investor club. And the members, they meet every month. And you can, what we discuss in the investor club is a particular industry, how it is doing, what are the components of the industry, which are the leading companies, and how to invest in a particular company, to buy or not to buy. You know, what are the signals which says stay away from companies, or what are the parameters which, you know, helps you to buy. So I would request you to go to the IMC website, and you will see the thing on investor club, and regular updates are given. You can register and you can come and attend, you know, the meeting. As the date is given over there, And of course, there is a small charge, but I would invite all of you to just come and experience, in January month, we will have, in the second week of January, there will be a session. It is about 2 hours from 5 to 7 at Indian Merchants Chamber at Churchgate. So I invite all of you all, whoever is interested in doing investment in shares, to come and attend these sessions, because we teach you how to select companies and how to make the investments. So can we have the mics, please? We will, start with, please raise your hands. Please go ahead.
Good evening, ma'am. Actually, we had an agenda over the certifications throughout the talk. So to Revati, ma'am, when you were telling that you look over for the screenings, you look for certain degrees like MBA or CFAs. So when you pursue for CFA, as we know, there are three levels. Suppose we clear CFA level 1 only, and correct me if I am wrong, that we cannot write in front if we haven't cleared all three levels. So clearing just one level, how would it add value to...